So I'm Moshe, and I'm working on this interface thing between AI and history for too many years. And my job today, I thought I talked with Michal and Noam, is to give you some things related to AI guy more perspective on things that are going in the interface. I realized that what I did is something very partial and extremely biased towards my own work, but never mind. And I still will leave the two last examples. I talk about theories, give you the taste of some theories, mostly by means of examples. And then the two last one are things that are more intrigued. I'm more intrigued these days, but I'd like to pass to you a particular message. So I'll try to take the whole hour and skip things which I think that you are more exposed to, like auctions. So here is the real story in my mind. So here you have a picture of two persons in Princeton in the 50s. You find here to the left John McCarthy, who coined the term AI and is considered the founder of AI, together with another guy that is his name appears soon. On the right, you have John Nash, that I guess you hear his name. And I just say that Princeton in the 50s was the time where John met John, which means this is a quote from Marvin Minsky's book. Marvin Minsky is another founder of AI, of learning in AI, neural networks, and others, that says, I learned even more from my own generation of students in Princeton, particularly John Nash, Lloyd Chapley, Martin Chupik, and John McCarthy. So these guys were really students like you guys, sitting in the same offices. They talk about these theories. I have many more quotes to give you. And now we realize, 50, 60 years later, that we have connections between the fields. Amazing. So Minsky and McCarthy are basically Turing 1 recipients and the fathers of reasoning and learning in AI, respectively. And you know Nash and Shapley. And many more interesting quotes you can find on that. So from that point on, they took different tracks. In fact, what AI took, and now is suddenly again, there is a boom that is considered successful, is something that is going toward a direction that I'll call it in today's terminology, personal assistance. I'd like to build an agent that will reason, optimize, learn, whatever, and do it well. While game theory took a more multi-agent context, but they talked about more stylized interaction and understanding these stylized interactions. But for me, again, for many, many years by now, the real dream that now becomes not as impossible as one may think is the design of what I'll call game theoretic agents, which is an ultimate challenge to AI. And I'd like to convey to you what are kind of the things that we have been doing in this regard. Mostly, they split into two parts. One of them I call agent design, which deals with the question of how should an agent, you see what is an agent, reason, plan, learn in order to optimize its activity facing other agents. So what should I do? And if you look at the game theory literature and you are honest, you see, you don't have really satisfactory answers that come from there. So what can you do? The other thing is a mediator design. So assume that you have many agents, you know, many autonomous vehicles, whatever, or many personal assistants or whatever, and you like somehow to moderate or tell them what to do, in a sense, in order that they will reach some good outcome or whatever. So how should you do that? And here you can think that you have some game theory can give you something such as equilibrium, say, just offer some kind of joint behavior, and if you are rational, you don't deviate from it, but you can understand that you may not like really always to rely on that. So these are the things that we like to go for. So what is the aim of this particular talk is just to share with you, and I just added a very biased perspective, of some of the theories emerge while addressing optimization, reasoning, and learning when required to be applicable in non-cooperative multi-agent settings. I'll emphasize the science part. I'll put one slide, which is another talk, the talk about return of investment, ROI, actually building such systems. It will not appear. It will be a scientific talk with the main ideas of the theories, just to give you like 8 or 9 pointers to theories with examples, and we'll be here to talk with you about these theories. So the basic idea is we like to move from what we call an agent perspective that decides what to do, and to a same situation where you are faced by many other decision makers, or when you need to somehow lead a set of agents to some desired behavior. So let's start from the following thing. Assume that, you know, we talk about agents, many of these agents do things like search. So you can think about Google or Bing, but now think about the situation where a user needs to decide which agent it like to use, whether it be Google or Bing, or more specifically it will be Cortana or Google Now, but let's think about search, a thing that everyone knows. So how it will decide what to do? So if you hear Ido Erev talk tomorrow, he'll tell you there are certain models of, you know, based on, you know, how to choose among two outcomes, but I'll take something which is very naive, which is consistent with what Ido will call relying on small samples, and this is actually what these people are doing. So this guy, for example, has a particular page in mind that is the most relevant for him if he searches for, say, movie reviews. So he will just look at the results and see whether his favorite page is ranked, where his favorite page is ranked, in Google or in Bing. So the higher his favorite page is ranked, the better, you know, this search engine is for him. And if Google really ranks it higher, then from this point on, basically, it will use Google. That's an extreme kind of model, but basically this is the kind of reasoning that is going on here. So that's very nice, but let's bring it into what we call the agent design perspective. What can we do? In fact, we may have in Google maybe not optimal, but let's assume that it's optimal. Optimal search engine that really knows the percentage of the population that really likes every page, and every person really likes a particular page, and this optimal search engine knows that this page is really desired by 18% of the population, so it put it first, and so on and so forth. So what can we do? This is great, great. But we cannot just copy it because people will keep on using this optimal one. So we can do the following trick. Take the page that is ranked the highest and put it last. What will happen now? If someone searches, then 82% of the population, 100% minus 18%, will find their favorite page higher. Sounds a bit tricky. So that is the extreme, but this is just a pointer to the fact that when you do design these agents or do search, you are already in competition. In fact, if you use any deterministic algorithm, it can be badly beaten. So, of course, the other search engine or the other agent can respond to that. Then you get some form of a game. This is the place where we move from optimization to what we call in this particular work, dueling algorithms. And this is a duel. Now you are in a duel. So basically, what we lack now is to efficiently compute optimal strategies, which are just poly-time, min-max, randomized algorithm for the duel. And one can ask new question. How competitive is the classical optimization algorithm? How often can it be beaten? And in fact, you can just define dual as a classical optimization problem, which can be arbitrary, but it's put in a competitive context. So we can go over many of them. So this is a whole theory that you can talk about, not just about ranking and give particular results, and you can talk about binary search, you can talk about routing, you can talk about the secretary problem, compression, for example, you have your Hoffman coding or whatever that you learned in school, but now you get a random input, and the question whether on the random input you cannot really defeat the Hoffman coding, and the answer to this, upper bound, lower bound, stuff like that, you can talk about traveling salesperson. So all of this theory that we call dueling algorithms basically says the following. Every optimization algorithm has a dual. Classic solutions can usually, not always, there are interesting cases they are not, can be badly beaten. And what the theory does, here we don't talk about theory, but just invitation to the theory, there are general techniques provided for solving dual, computing optimal strategies in the game. So you'd like to do what will be the best for this compression, I'll give you an algorithm. So it's part of a more general kind of technique. So this is the idea of the first example. This will be an example in our talk that is called dueling algorithms that emphasize the following. We talk about AI with GT flavor, We now talk about agent design theories, which is we look at the participatory form in agent. And what we said is that optimization needs to be revisited. And what we suggest is the theory of dueling algorithms. In fact, this is actually what happens. When you look at this situation, what you care about is basically when you compete with different algorithms is how good or better you are than your competitor, relatively your competitor, on random inputs. So this is an example of a theory. But as you can see, it's restricted conceptually. I think it's very general, but it doesn't deal with general types of reasoning, let's say. You have a non-cooperative game, as you know, in game theory, and stuff like that. So let's look at another theory that deals with what we call in AI reasoning. So this is taken, this is quite old work that I've been involved with, and it comes basically from EE, from the canonical problem that really people in EE cared about much before our community. And this talks about routing. So we know congestion, but let's talk about zero example as they stated it. In fact, that's a particular instance. We'll talk about the general problem in a minute. And the question is very simple. You have two agents. They need to choose among fast service provider and slow service provider. And it's better to use the fast service provider, of course, if you are alone there. But you have this kind of congestion effect. And if both agents choose the same service provider, then the service is split among the two. So it may be better to use the slow service provider alone than to share the fast service provider with another agent. It's very simple. You all know the game. It's formalized here as a game. And what these guys do, and I think people in computer science will do the same, will be we normalize the fast service provider, let's say, to have a speed or service of one, and the slow service provider to be alpha between half at one, so the things will not be trivial. And now what they emphasize, and also we emphasize, is equilibrium of this game. So you go, and in this community, people typically are interested in symmetric equilibrium. The game is symmetric. You look at symmetric equilibrium. There are a mixed strategy symmetric equilibrium. And it tells you to use the fast service provider with probability 2 minus alpha over 1 plus alpha. Very standard. And in fact, a lot of things go over that. We have great people that do this related stuff. But now let's back to my perspective as an AI guy. That's great. Equilibrium may be of interest from a descriptive perspective, perhaps. But would you actually recommend your agent the strategy prescribed in the Nash equilibrium? Would you really recommend it? Perhaps yes. Some of my best friends, do that. But you'll agree that it would be better if you can guarantee something. If you can, let's say, you can do the following kind of thing. You can use your safety level strategy, your probabilistic max mean kind of thing. So you can look at this game, look at the probabilistic algorithm that it's, guaranteed to you the best possible in the worst case, and try to use it. And if you look at this game, and by the way, it will be hard for you to find other games, but it's not the topic of that, you'll see that the safety level strategy does not define a Nash equilibrium, but in this game, as far as the mixed strategy in this symmetric game, the expected payoff of it is as you obtained in this Nash equilibrium. The expected payoff is the same. So when I've seen this in the first time, I say, oh, come on, what game theory has probably noticed this, because it appears in many kind of situations. So they notice this. There is a paper by Bob Oman that basically point to this game, come from different origins, do the same kind of things, basically look at the equilibrium of this game, say, okay, we have here equilibria, but the safety level strategy guarantees to me the same than in the safety level strategy as in the Nash equilibria. So why should I really use the Nash equilibrium strategy? That's like something against this modeling in equilibrium concept. But we are wearing the AI hat. I'd like to treat it more positively. And this is, we have done it already 15 years ago, and it says the following. Okay, perhaps I cannot really guarantee what I obtain in Nash equilibrium, but perhaps I can get close to it. So given a game G and a set of strategies S for the agent, a mixed strategy or probabilistic algorithm T will be called C-competitive safety level strategy if the ratio between the expected payoff of the agent in a Nash equilibrium is to its expected payoff in T is bounded by C. In some cases, we refer even to the best Nash equilibrium. And if C is small, we really have a good suggestion to our agent. Those of you who are young enough in order to show that to remind you the price of anarchy or whatever. In fact, these things grew in parallel. So we were interested in something that became much less popular than the price of anarchy. We compare other things. So what can we say here? So I'll share with you one of the results that was a surprise to my colleague in EE. So this is the things that appear in our yellow dye, all of these guys' kind of papers. So you look at the game, it's the same game that we talked about before, but now we have many agents and the service is split equally. It's like linear between the agent and the user service provider. And then suddenly it turns out that there exists a 9/8 competitive safety strategy for the extended decentralized load balancing. They call it the extended decentralized load balancing. And it turns out that such results can be obtained for quite a few settings studied in the CS and AI literature. So I'd like to give you, perhaps we don't have a lot of time, so I just glance through because I know that here I looked at this, I know the subject and people are interested in auctions. I'll not talk about auctions, but if you talk about other auctions, you can define it, and you talk about some reasonable distributions, and you talk about GSP, I'll not go over these discussions, and you look now at competitive safety strategies where all you assume is the agents cannot, you know, not overbid, they not submit bids which are higher than their valuation, then for linear decreasing click rates, you get a competitive ratio of 2, and if your valuation is small, you get close to 1 safety level, competitive safety ratio, thing that we have already used in practice in doing very nice bidding. So in fact, you have can guarantee on the bidder behavior in something like GSP. But all my claim here is just a means of examples. So what I say is that such results can be obtained for quite a few, many is perhaps too much, of the setting discussed in the CI/CLI literature. And if you'd like to take a take-home message, if it was dueling, think always about the duel. We'd like to optimize what my competitor will do. It's not optimization, it's dueling. Here, when you come to reasoning, try pessimism. It can actually work. And in fact, just to give you some, you can talk about it later, but take these 2x2 games that exist in all of these books and just assume that, you know, there is, the safety level is mixed, then suddenly you get that phenomena. So it appears in many, many situations. Okay, so for us, it was just our second example. We have many examples. And the second example on the agent theory. So we look at the perspective of an agent, and we like to talk about reasoning. And this was like dueling was here, an example. Here, the competitive safety analysis was another example. But in a sense, from an AI perspective, again, even more interesting situation is the situation where the system is really has uncertainty and you need to learn and you don't know, the situation is dynamic. So back to the origins of the, I told you this is a scientific talk, but there are many applications what you're talking about on what happens when the environment is dynamic and initially unknown. So think about a business that needs to choose the type of advertising campaign. It will be billboards or under the cap campaigns or whatever. And you might not know how this selected action, what will be the outcome, this and how it will compare to the revenues of the others and so on. But you can observe the outcome after actions have been taken and attempt to learn over time. In fact, this is things that appear everywhere. I can give you zillions of examples because what I just described to you is an instance of the setting which is called reinforcement learning in stochastic games. So what is this? Now suddenly I jump to a very general model. So here we have Shapley. We cannot have the talk anymore. My talk without Shapley. So we have a stochastic game introduced by Shapley in 1953 in parallel to Bellman's MDPs. In fact, although it was much more general, and I guess that you know the model, but still, I'd like to emphasize several points. So you have an agent, and let's call the rest the adversary. You have an agent and an adversary, and the agent chooses an action, a particular state. The state is a stage game, and now based on the agent's action and the adversary action, you get a particular payoff, and this also determines the transition probabilities to a new state where you play a new game. So you can notice that this is a very general model. Because if I tell you something positive about this mega creature, then a particular case, bless you, Michal, The case of repeated games is just when you have one state and you keep on returning to the same state. And the case of MDPs is just the case where the adversary has a single action. So it's a very general model. And in this model, we are after a very general task, which is here not defined on its details, but you should believe me. So the agent doesn't, assume that the agent doesn't know initially the pair of matrices and transition probabilities. When it's a particular state, it recognizes the state. When you perform an action, it can later on see the actions performed and to see the payoffs, but it doesn't know the transition probabilities and the payoff matrices initially. And the agent's aim is very, very ambitious. We'd like to attain near optimal guaranteed expected average reward. Assume that we like to have something that can, like safety level or something like that. We like to guarantee a particular reward, but we don't know the actual system initially. So we'd like to attain near optimal guaranteed expected average reward quickly. Attain quickly almost the optimal expected average reward an agent can guarantee itself against arbitrary adversary behavior when it knows the payoff matrices and transition probabilities. So many things here are not defined, but just to, if there are people that come from stochastic games or whatever in the audience, then I'd like to say, what is polynomial? Polynomial here means polynomial in the mixing time of the optimal policy, not on the states itself. It's really what we want. You have a stochastic game, you can guarantee to yourself, it has epsilon return mixing time, and in the epsilon return mixing time of this optimal policy that is obtained using dynamic programming, you would like really to obtain something close to this value in time which is polynomial in this. You cannot ask for more. So what is the challenge here? The challenge here is a big challenge that we bring as AI guys to another thing that we have built, which is called explore and exploit, which means how all of this literature works. If it comes from OR or from statistics or whatever, it says you don't know the environment, then you explore, and after you learned enough, you can try to exploit. And there are very interesting statistical tests about you can move from exploration to exploitation. But you have an adversary, then an adversary may prevent you from exploring. So you try to exploit, so the adversary may prevent you from exploiting. So what can you do? So I'll tell you the trick that by now has been extended by many others, and this is a joint work with my very good friend, Ronen Braffman, and the original algorithm is called the RMAX algorithm, and it goes as follows. Again, it will be a very clean message. It's not telling you about the whole results. What we do is we are using a model-based learning algorithm that utilizes an optimistic fictitious model. What do we mean by that? We start with a fully optimistic kind of assumptions. We assume that the maximal payoff is Rmax, and then we assume that at each entry of a game that we don't know yet, we should define what is known, then you assume that you get the Rmax payoff. And if you don't know the transition probabilities originated from it, then you move with probability one to a state of happiness that you'll get the maximal payoff and stay there forever. So what is known should be careful because it's after you have observed enough transitions. There are Chernoff bounds hidden, but that's the basic idea. You are optimistic. When you don't know something, you are optimistic. And what you do with this optimistic model, you just exploit. You compute optimal policy, execute the current policy, and update the model, which means record rewards and update transition probabilities after observed enough times. So you just revise your model in the minimal way, roughly speaking, and stay optimistic. That's, I would say that's a very Israeli kind of mode. You are completely optimistic, it's Moshe mode, optimistic mode. Really optimistic, and you cannot fight with realities, and you revise, and you keep on being optimistic. So it turns out, when you put up the details, that this basically addresses the problem. So Rmax, when put in with the details, was the first near-optimal polynomial time algorithm for reinforcement learning in stochastic game, addressing the exploration versus exploitation problem in hostile environments. Now, there is a particular lemma here that is called the implicit explore-exploit lemma that I like to explain. So what is the intuition here? Why optimism is so useful? So the idea is the following. You have an adversary. So you go to the adversary and say, Mr. Adversary, look, I'll be optimistic. And you do what we want. Is adversary. You have two options. Either you don't like to reveal to me any information, and then I just keep on getting very high payoff. or you like that I not get this payoff, then you need to, you know, to expose, you know, to tell me something. So I even don't know whether I exploit, but, you know, I know that I'll do one of the two. And you put the details there of the probabilities or whatever, it turns out that this go all the way through and enable us to address this problem, even if you don't know the mixing time and all of these nice things. So this is a substitute to the explicit exploit by Cairns and Singh, if you know, very classical work that says, basically, you explore until you know if nothing says exploit, and now come the implicit exploit. By the way, it's also a deterministic algorithm, the first one to do it in MDPs. So the basic message here, every theory would have a message. RMOX exploits the adoption of optimistic bias to solve the challenge of learning to optimize in adversarial context. So for that, I told you to be pessimistic. Now it's okay, this was when you didn't have a particular situation, but you need to be optimistic about nature. Or if you wish, positive psychology can actually work. So this was the example of this agent kind of theories when you talk about learning. So we've seen talk about optimization, reasoning and learning, and the kind of theories that have been emerging. But now I'd like to move forward with my examples. And here we move from them more. Yeah, of course, we'll be able to tell you more, and not just my own bias. So now we'd like to move from agent design to mediator design. Again, because there are many people that here are interested in mechanism design, we can have a whole session about the difference between what I call mediator and the mechanism design. You can call it mechanism design. I think that there is a change in the mode, as you'll see in a minute. When we talk about mediator design, what I have in mind is something that the game is already given, and we try to adapt the game in order to obtain something. It will be very clear in our first example. Of course, you can call it a certain form of mechanism design. I don't design the whole game, but the game is already given, and I try to change it. And the question is, what is the power of the mediator? And we can argue for long what exists more, mechanism design, mediator design in our societies. Anyway, so think about some ways or whatever that need basically to navigate the people or someone that need to mitigate personal assistance. So we talk about mediators, and I'll get to the mode, it's very important to understand what is the power of these mediators. Can they enforce behavior, as we'll see? Can they just incent some of behavior, promise payments? Or they just put a stage, which will be a convenient stage, a computerized setting, that will enable us to work nicely. And there is a whole spectrum in between, and this will be the things which are on my recent everyday agenda these days, because they are connected very much to the internet and data science in the internet. But let's talk about these examples first. So what do we mean by enforce? One slide about enforcement. So here I'm really biased because it's work that we've started about 30 years ago, and we do it these days in the Technion with mobile robots. So this is called Social Laws for Artificial Agent Societies, and the idea is as follows. Kind of reading this slide, think about really the reality of mobile robots or autonomous vehicles or whatever you like to call it. You know, you have traffic laws. This will be an example of social laws. So I'd like to move from one place to the other. So there can be a centralized solution that will take all of the robots where to go. Instead, you can just go, and then there will be many conflicts, and you'll solve them locally. Or, as we all know, there can be certain constraints that are imposed in advance, such as traffic laws. So we basically interfere with the system. We don't build a new system, but we just design certain constraints on the agent activity. So given a multi-agent system, in an offline phase, we provide constraints on the agent's behavior, which will allow each agent in the online phase to act individually, to do planning, what we call in AI, but never mind, and succeed well, regardless of the behavior of other agents, as long as all agents conform to the pre-designed laws. So there is, you can understand there is a fixed point problem here. We call it golden mean problem. We say, I like to constrain the behavior of agents, but not to constrain them too much. Because still, each agent has to have enough freedom in order to come, it gets a dynamic goal, and need to get from here to there. So I can just work in the world that if I conform to the law and I guarantee that the others conform to the law, I'll be guaranteed to obtain my goal or relatively efficiently, regardless of what the other agents do, as long as they conform to the law. And this has been working very nicely in the past, in my very, very old days in the robotics lab in Microsoft, but now we revisit it and we can more than welcome to look at this in the context of mobile robots. So, but basically, the agenda is looking at this kind of particular problems. So I just wanted to talk a bit very briefly, just to mention that this is the example where you can really impose the law. So I can assume that every vehicle really obey this law, which is very extreme. So I'd like to spend some time on another case situation where the mediator really cannot really enforce the law, but it can really, it's reliable, but it cannot really punish you or things like that. So this refers to a work that carried out for quite a few years by good colleague Dov Monderer, and it's basically say the following. Think about a mediator that all that it has is its own reliability. So what it means by that, he can promise payments and he will pay them if particular joint actions are executed. He cannot punish agents. He cannot say, if you don't do it, you'll need to pay me or expose secrets. Of course, he's not crazy because if this mediator can just promise you zillions of dollars if you do something, so he'd like to minimize the payments. And moreover, as you see, we are not crazy about Nash equilibrium, so it will be nice if they will be able to lead to the desired behavior, not just by paying not too much money, but this will be obtained using dominant strategies. So dominant strategies is harder to, that is like the holy grail of our mediation device. Let's put it in dominant strategy. In fact, we can talk about group dominant strategies, but let's leave it aside. So an example and then a pointer to the whole theory. So you know this game, this is the battle of the sexes, and you have these two agents, the husband and wife, they can choose declare either boxing or concert. If they disagree, then they stay home, low payoff. If they agree, then the wife prefers boxing, that she gets two and the husband gets one, and the other way around for concert. And there is a very nice Nash equilibrium here. Let's say both declare boxing. It's a Nash equilibrium, it maximizes social welfare, and everything is great. But why someone should use this equilibrium? So, think about this as now as money, millions of dollars or dollars. So I'll add utilities and money for this sake of this example. And think about the following mediator. The mediator he's reliable, it can promise payments. So the mediator can have the following kind of thing to say. Say, look, I'll pay you 10, you the raw agent, if the joint action boxing and concert will be performed. I promise, and I do that, to pay 10 you, the column agents, if the pair concert and boxing is performed. So I just changed the game. Look at the new game. In this game, suddenly there is a dominant strategy. 2 is better than 0, 10 is better than 1, and similarly, 1 is better than 0, and 10 is better than 2 for the column agent. So it's great. They'll perform boxing and boxing. I'm the mediator, how much I need to pay? I need to pay nothing. I didn't promise anything for this pair of boxing and boxing. So basically, I just use my reliability in order to lead you as a dominant strategy to pay something very desired that I didn't pay anything. So what's going on here? In fact, that's an example of what we call a theory of K implementation. It basically tells you, one of the theorems there will tell you that any Nash, even correlated equilibrium, can be implemented as a dominant strategies equilibrium z uses zero cost. And the type of mediators, this is the type of mediators that modify the games in a way that allows for the implementation of desired behavior and dominant strategy. More generally, the theorem tells you, I don't like to talk about, to compromise on the solution concept. I'd like to believe in dominant strategies, but what will be the minimal pay that I need to pay here in order to make all of this into kind of dominant strategy. A theory that is called K-implementation, dealing with the minimal pay required to order to make a desired behavior is the theory of K-implementation. And the take-home message from this example, or from this example of the theory, is that reliable promises are extremely effective, really extremely effective, and can be very cheap if you design them carefully. So this was an example of incent. And I hesitated to get to the third example, but I'll give it. And it turns out this was something that philosophically bothered me for quite a time. This refers to what happens if the mediator can just put the stage. What would put the stage? You don't understand it. It's just a computer. So the fact that you can let, what can happen if you just let the participant play in a computing device rather than play in the big world. Again, why it bothers me for quite a time? Because it sometimes, as a computer scientist, I realize, so do you care to talk about people? We talk about machines. What is the difference? I take we have a decision maker. Is it a machine? Is it a person? And this was the first time that I realized that there is a difference, really difference, not just the fact that it's NP-hard or complexity or stuff like that, between machines, human machines and people, in things that really economists couldn't really notice. So I'll give you the example. This will be another example of a mediator device. So this is another really cool idea of computer science. We need to be very proud of it. It came from Turing and von Neumann independently. And they both introduced something which is highly to be appreciated, which is called the dual role of computer programs. Basically, it says that all that you know, a computer program can serve simultaneously as a string of bits, data, and as a set of instructions. So it can easily write a computer program that can read itself and other programs and based on it decide what to do. So it's elementary, but it's very, very nice. It solves very many circular kind of arguments. I can be simultaneously a set of instructions and data set. Let's take it seriously. Consider real computer programs which possess capabilities as described starting von Neumann and Turing work. So what does it mean? So this is a community of theorists, but if you talk it in Microsoft, they immediately say, oh, it's bots or agents. Everyone have the same name. It changes from every 2 years. So we have different participants or players that submit their own programs, which will run on the same computer server to determine the actions to be taken. This is the so-called proxies or agents or bots model. So basically, I can refer in the shared memory to other programs or whatever. So what happens now? If you take it seriously, in fact, I'll illustrate it, again, a general theory, but I'll illustrate it in a classical kind of thing, the prisoner's dilemma. So the prisoner's dilemma, the most celebrated game. So we have these two agents, and need to decide whether to cooperate or defect. If both of them cooperate, they get a reasonable payoff. If they both defect, they get a low payoff. And one defects, and the other cooperates, and the one who defected gets a very high, and the one that cooperated gets a very low. You can put in your other numbers. And as you know, there is a dominant strategy equilibrium that calls for defection, while there is another joint action which is much better for both, which is cooperation. It's unbelievable. I did it with Ehud Kalaylpas. How many papers have been written about trying to settle this kind of issue? In fact, I would say that many of the things that happens in introducing even repeated games came from this kind of idea of how we can, you know, deal with kind of related issue. But let's stay with one-shot game. And let's assume, consider the following program that someone can write. I'll skip the syntax and semantics. It appears in papers. But anyway, you can understand what is going on here. Look at the following program that says, if my program equals your program, then do cooperate. Else, do defect. So what's written here? The program of a particular programmer instructs the computer to compare its content as a file to the content as a file, a string of bits, as the context of the other programmer's program. And if this syntactic comparison, these bit strings are equal, then it tells them to cooperate and otherwise to defect. This is completely fine using the Turing-von Neumann kind of idea. So what's going on here? The above so-called tricky but well-defined program basically determines what we call a program equilibrium for the one-shot prisoner's dilemma. You can check that it's irrational for each agent to deviate from its program, assuming that the others stick to its program. So the von Neumann and Turing idea allows us, in fact, to escape circular arguments. And in fact, what they do, they implement a mediator device. I'll not tell you what this mediator device basically says. You know, if only one guy will defect, I'll play defect on the other. But never mind. So it actually allows us to implement this kind of thing in a program, in a classical kind of game theoretic setting, but when you have the ability of this kind of programs. As a result, you get mutual cooperation in the one-shot prisoner's dilemma. The result is much more general. Program equilibrium is a Nash equilibrium of computer programs. There is particular syntax and semantics that we introduced many years ago. Others have expanded this. There is a way by Kalai and by Gilboa and Summit and others. The basic message here, there is something here which basically is a Fock theorem, but basically it tells you what will tell you. People here are more familiar with game theories than I'll tell. Basically what this tells you, then you can get the phenomena, the whole set of phenomena that you get in the Fock theorem in economics and repeated games, all of the richness with all of the variants, in a one-shot game when you move to programs. So basically, if you wish to be positive, it tells you that the results show that the emergence of cooperative outcomes can be obtained in the context enabled by computers as alternative to repeated games. So this was an example of, we just put the stage. We understood that we can put these servers here and let them play using more sophisticated kind of programs. So, wow. So we talked a little bit about agent design theories and mediator design theories. I tried to convey something, but now I'd like to show you my more recent excitement even. In fact, I hope that I'm not getting crazy, but I'm seeing mediators everywhere. And I guess really they should be revisited given the game theory flavor. I think here we have an amazing kind of challenge. It's really, I'll tell you just about two because I don't like to take more time. I'll share you with two kind of things that I've been involved with recently, which can be just expand this to recommendation and ranking. I'll give you two examples. So basically, what is the structure? It takes time to understand. Basically, it turns out that information retrieval search is an exercise in mediators. Why? You have publishers basically choose strategies, but these are called in IR language models. And you have the mediator, which is, let's say, Google, that basically use a ranking function. And you have then basically the publishers that like to be ranked high. So how it goes? Let's start from a quote from a company that I really appreciate, Google. It says the following. It's a quote from the site. When you sit down at your computer and do a Google search, you are almost instantly presented with a list of results from all over the web. So, and then they continue and say the important thing. When you perform a Google search, our program checks our index to determine the most relevant search result to be returned or served to you. That's great. And they really do it. So I'm not thinking about it as a game theorist. Publisher strategies are the documents they write. And in the commercial world that I come from, it's very strategic. There are different names of this. They call search engine optimization, SEO, whatever. They really talk about it. We talk about also the experiments in a minute. And the payoff of the publishers are basically determined by the ranking for different queries, how high I'm ranked. So the ranking function is employed by a mediator. So I hope that you see the picture. At least in the commercial world, and we talk about data soon, basically there are strategies for the publishers. And basically now, think about broadcasting channels or whatever, if it's more convenient to you, instead of thinking about language models. And now the ranking function is basically a mediation device. In fact, when you look at it and understand mediators, classical information retrieval uses implicitly a very simple mediation device. It just implements it very efficiently. It has a name in the experts world, in the world IR expert. It's called the probability ranking principle, PRP. The PRP, the most central concept in information retrieval, Owen Kuhland allows me to say that, and I say it, states that the documents should be ranked by the relevant probabilities, and we care about the highest ranked documents. So what's wrong with that? The PRP just fails in adversarial information retrieval settings, where publishers are search engine optimizers that try to promote their pages. It basically, what happens now, it can be shown, both theoretically and experimentally, this is paper on theory, and then we have also experimental papers, that in equilibrium of this game, people will tend to write on similar topics. And as a result, the user social welfare will decrease in equilibrium. It shouldn't be, after we say it, I'm not sure that it should be really a surprise. You know the TV news channels, right? From time to time, you see that they converge to having the same news. Why? Because you have a ranking function. You break the thing that, you know, most important. So you keep on, you like to be ranked higher, then you start to, on esoteric thing, you stop writing on. That's the intuition, if you wish. And it turns out that in general settings, you can replace this mediator device by more probabilistic kind of mediator, ranking function, that we can be shown to be better as far as social welfare in equilibrium. So I'm saying something that I don't like to be sound too extreme, but what I'm saying is not that the search engine don't do the best with the data. I'm just saying that we could have received, got very different data if you use different ranking functions, and as a result, the social welfare could have increased. This is part of evidence from experiments that is called the adversarial search research experiments. I'll not bother you with all of this. This is, of course, with the setting, where basically we can even show that basically we can just predict how someone will change its document. And what we see here is high bars are the high weights that this prediction gives to the similarity that your document, basically the similarity to the current winners, the ones that ranked high. So basically it's obvious that it depends on the context, but it basically depends that people try to mimic others. And this is this phenomenon that actually happens. There is still some tension here between theory and practice and a very long range project about this, because it can have interesting ramifications. You still need to wait before we replace the search engines, but there is time. This is one example of a mediator. The other, it will be the last one, I think, that I'd like to give is about recommendation systems. So we all use this kind of recommendation systems currently, right? This is Waze or whatever. What is this mediator? It's someone that basically try to interfere with the process of learning or social learning or whatever. So people just go particular directions, and now there is a mediator that really connect the data and based on the data try to recommend to you some course of action. So what we call economic recommendation systems basically is the process of designing a mediator protocol, which by observing the agent's actions, success, and recommending actions guarantees efficient outcome, and in particular allow for effective exploration. What do we mean by that? Again, I'd like to, there's a mixture here of two things. So we'd like basically to do exploration exploitation. We cannot really navigate or do anything without exploration, right? We need to crowd someone somehow to explore alternatives. But if you know the algorithm, and moreover, if you can see others, then you may realize that you are just a guinea pig or whatever, and you don't choose the right action. By the way, the report says that it appears more and more. Of course, people don't do the game theory in their head, but they feel, why they send me there? Why they ask me for do that? And they not follow the protocol. So it would be really great if you could solve the following challenge of why should I explore? Or why should I explore even more where, given that I see others' actions and familiar with the mediator protocol? So let me give some credit. The case where we don't see others, which doesn't fit our economic recommendation system, but just think about exploration exploitation in a bandit kind of settings, where basically you don't say, why should I explore if I know everything? I know the mediator protocol. I know that I may be something inferior here that I go to explore. Why should I do it? There are very nice papers by Kremer, Mansour, and Perry that really address this. It's fascinating. And then we realize that we thought it will be impossible, but basically we say, okay, what happens if the people can see the actions of others? This is called in social learning, basically, in the literature of game theory. So let's assume that we have the same setting, but there is a network, and in the network you can really see also others. So it turns out that there exist really realistic, I can give you the protocol and the word for realistic settings, it's also sufficiently necessary conditions we have on that, on the network, on the agent visibility graph, under which there exist an economic accommodation system which will yield asymptotically optimal outcome, and asymptotically doesn't mean fast, it will be quite fast, where agents follow the recommendation in incentive compatible manner. So we can promise you for this kind of visibility graph that what I recommend to you is really the best that you can do. So this is another type of mediators that do that. So I need to wrap up. So just on the big pictures. So it's really, I think that AI guys, and you know, maybe many of you don't see yourself AI guys, but I think they are very close, need to talk about the game theory flavor. And it's not just saying, okay, we know the same things or whatever, but basically there are very careful kind of new theories that need to be considered. One of them, part of them is, what happens if I need to take a decision? Not really be descriptive, but be prescriptive or normative. What should I do? And we have seen several, if you see, we struggle with it. It's not simple. We talk about dwelling as an extension to optimization, on the pessimistic approach that can work in forced reasoning, optimistic that can go really all the way through in this case to replace classical reinforcement learning. In the mediation, you've seen social laws, that's a whole theory, the K-implementation and program equilibrium. And moreover, here the last row, I can add to you many more, because really what we have in the internet is basically a bunch of mediators that have implemented without really people not even noticing that they are mediators. And when we look at it and say, okay, let's understand what they're doing as a mediator, we can start and get interesting stuff. Okay, in order to wrap up, back to the big picture of John and John. In fact, you are more than invited to look at this, both of the Society of Mind, Marvin Minsky book, when instead of taking on the mind, the neural nets, who also talk about his friends. And of course, in Beautiful Mind. In fact, in Beautiful Mind, I find the following funny quote that says that you actually thought about designing games together. So here is a story. Nash Shapley, Shubik, and McCarthy, along with another student at Princeton, invented a game involving coalitions and double crosses. Amazing game, by the way. And Nash gave his, in his own way, a very nice game. Fuck you, buddy. And it was a very interesting kind of situation about the synergy between this guy. You can see that they've been friends, but they went in different directions. What I try to convey to you that there are things that are try to really connect this. And I think that we are getting close. It's an uphill battle, but there is cool progress. In my view, perhaps it's a minority view, but I think it's very nice kind of progress. One thing that a caveat that I didn't talk about, I talk a very scientific work. This I can tell you that we can move from science here to ROI, to return on investment. I don't know how much of you care about this, but it's true. So from ideas in dwelling algorithms to competing ad auctions, from learning to optimize to bidding in ad exchanges, from mediator design, the signal information in display ads. And you shouldn't be shy, because I think that the idea that comes from this intersection here with game theory, that people try to be let's use some machine learning, at least my experience can bring significant ROI with the right blend of AI and game theory. So I'll stop here. I thought I would make acknowledgments, and I realized that I did not make acknowledgments. I got put here acknowledgments to all of my colleagues in the Technion that did most of the work, to my colleagues in Microsoft Research, like these guys, that I didn't describe our work, but they responsible to everything. And for the last slide, for many, many, I didn't talk about it, many, many colleagues in the Microsoft Israel R&D Center that are responsible for much of the ROI that have been obtained in the INGT blend. So I just contribute a little. So I'll stop here. So I hope it wasn't too many kind of theories, but I'll be more than happy to talk about each particular one or expand. Be here today, I hope also tomorrow. So thank you for listening.